Welcome to Creekside Online. We are so glad you are here. We have some exciting news in addition to Creekside Online, which you can watch every week, all week long. And Creekside Outside, where you can join us in the back parking lot every Sunday at 9. On October 11th, we will host Creekside Inside.
That's right, Creekside Inside. So here is what Creekside Inside will look like. There'll be two services, 9 and 11, in the venue, where there'll be a live host who welcome you and kick off the service, where together we will participate in worship with the Creekside Online video service. Now, each service can accommodate 100 people, so attendance will be by reservation and will open weekly on the Thursday prior to the Sunday service. A COVID-19 release form will be required to participate. If you've not already completed one, forms can be completed online when you make your reservation or completed when you arrive for the service. It's easy and only one is needed for the entire family, and you just need to fill out one and then it's good to go for the weeks to come. So please join us, and of course, social distancing and masking protocols will be in place.
You may be asking, what about my kids? Well, Creekside Kids Outside is going great and will still be offered during the 9 o'clock service. So whether you attend Creekside Inside or Creekside Outside at 9, Creekside Kids Outside will be available also by pre-reservation on Thursday. Just allow yourself enough time to check in your kids in the back parking lot and make it back over to the venue.
So registration for October 11th will be open on October 8th, and we'll have the registration link up on creeksideeg.com. Okay, so the other huge thing we have going on is the Great Harvest Treasure Hunt. I hope you have your sign up in your lawn. If not, make sure to grab one at the church. We want to see them everywhere.
We also need lots of candy and volunteers.
Yes, we need lots of candy, mm-hmm. Don't we? Definitely lots of candy. And if you want to volunteer, just go to creeksideeg.com/harvest-volunteers to see how you can be a part in loving our community by volunteering for this event.
And don't forget, but registration is now open. Here is a message from Pirate Matt himself.
Ahoy there, Elk Grove. Welcome to the Great Harvest Treasure Hunt, the most epic adventure you'll ever be a part of. Make sure you register online for this event. It'll be happening on October 31st, and registration opens on October 1st. So check out our website, register your cars for this drive-through treasure hunt. It's gonna be the greatest in all the land, or at least this side of Elk Grove. Join us for the Great Harvest Treasure Hunt. We'll see you soon.
It is going to be so much fun, so definitely post a sign, volunteer, give candy, and let all the kids of Elk Grove know that treasure will be found all across Elk Grove on October 31st.
Yeah, that's right. Okay, we have two more things to let you know about. First is we are offering a Love and Logic parenting class starting October 7th and continuing every Wednesday evening on Zoom until November 18th. It's going to be led by the head of our counseling department, Mike Beckner. You can register for the class at creeksideeg.com/marriage-family.
Whether you need some COVID parenting tips or just want to sharpen your parenting skills, this is an excellent course led by the pro, so don't miss this opportunity.
All right, and the last thing I want to let you know about is that next Sunday, October 11th, we will be baptizing people at the Creekside Outside service at 9 o'clock. So come join us and celebrate. And maybe you too have been thinking about being baptized. Well, we will be giving an opportunity to be baptized after the Creekside Outside service, as well as 1 o'clock in the afternoon on Sunday the 11th. So check us out and come join us there as well.
Hey, if this is your first time joining us, or maybe we haven't had a chance to say hello to you, make sure you text the word guest to 888-111 because we want to say hello.
Indeed, and if you need some prayer or anything else, text the words need prayer to 888-111 and we will reach out to you as well.
can give to Creekside by texting the word give to the number here on the screen.
And also at the end of Pastor Scott's sermon, he will be leading us in communion. So you may want to gather some bread and juice to join with him. But right now, let's join together in worship.
Welcome. So glad you've joined us for our online service. Wherever you are, we invite you to join with us to sing, to worship our great God. As we sing of his amazing grace, the God who gave it all, we're going to worship him together. Let's sing.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Amazing grace.
Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Aren't you grateful all he's done for us? When we were far from him, he came for us. He came, he poured it all out. God who gave it all for us. So that in response, we can love him and we can love others in a world around us that just desperately needs it. Right now, listen to these words from 1 Peter chapter 4. This is starting at verse 8. Above all, love each other deeply, because love covers over a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. God's grace. Our world is in need of grace right now, right on? People need tangible expressions of God's love and grace in their lives. And whether that's at church here or in your sphere of influence at home or school or work or wherever, there's people that need what God has given you. Maybe it's a kind word you offer. Maybe it's provision. God will lead and guide us right as we seek him. But we want to be good stewards of what God has given us to share his grace in a world that needs it. Right on? Right on. Let's just pray how we can do that this week. We come to a God who gave it all, and we give it back to him. He gave it completely. And that's what we want to do, is bring our whole selves to him and say, God, all I am is yours. Let's sing this chorus together. All stand. Let's sing like this.
So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. Yes, I'll stand, my soul, Lord, to you surrendered all. I am is yours, yeah. So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. Yes, I'll stand, my soul, Lord, to you surrendered all. Offer this heart, oh God, completely to you.
Welcome to Creekside Online. My name is Scott Hansen. I'm pastor here, and I want to remind us all that a couple of months ago, we took a dive into a really cool journey through the book of Acts entitled The Church Ignited. And before we dive back into the text on the journey before us in Acts 6, I just want to do a little bit of review of ground already covered so we're all on the same playing field, okay? Acts chapter 1, waiting for Holy Spirit power. Jesus Christ commissioned his followers to reach the whole world with this life-transforming message of the cross and the empty tomb. But until they received power from the Holy Spirit, they were simply to wait in Jerusalem. And then Jesus ascended back into heaven. Acts chapter 2, receiving Holy Spirit power. The Holy Spirit did come in power, violent wind, tongues of fire, God. He lit a match and he threw it into this highly combustible group of early Christ followers, and they began to do exactly what Jesus had told them to do. They were the church ignited, and they started boldly sharing their faith first in Jerusalem. The result was 3,000 new believers, and the church was born. Acts chapter 3. yielding to Holy Spirit power. A great miraculous healing takes place. A lame man is made able to walk, and the results were that they had another opportunity for a spiritual harvest in Jerusalem. 2,000 more people were added to God's family. Acts chapter 4, responding to opposition with Holy Spirit power. Peter and John are interrogated before the Sanhedrin, which is the Jewish Supreme Court, and they were interrogated for the healing that occurred, and they were commanded to never speak publicly again about Jesus Christ, but they courageously, filled with the Holy Spirit, they insisted that they had to obey God rather than people, because Jesus is the only name, Jesus is the only way that we can find eternal salvation. Acts chapter 5. Internal and external challenges. First, internal challenges. God has to deal rather severely with sin in the church. The first 11 verses. While people are giving generously to the work of the church, they're giving houses, property, other assets to bless and further the work of God. There's one family that decides to try to deceive God, hold back a part of the property and say they'd given it all. They lied to the Holy Spirit, and this couple's sin cost them their lives. God put them to death, and he brought a purifying fire into the church, as well as a vivid reminder that he's a holy God. He's an all-knowing God, and we don't trifle with this God. And then from verse 12 on, we have the apostles tested again by persecution, an external problem. More apostolic miracles in the temple, more preaching, again arrested. This time it looks like all the apostles are thrown in jail, miraculously released by an angel from jail. They're rearrested after preaching again, interrogated by the same Sanhedrin. And this time the apostles come very close to being killed, but someone intervenes in the last minute. And instead of killing them, they whip them instead, and again severely threaten them to keep quiet about Jesus or else. And we read their response in Acts chapter 5 at the end of the chapter, verse 40, that says this: they called the apostles in and they had them flogged. And then they ordered them not to speak in the name of Jesus, and they let them go. The apostles left the Sanhedrin rejoicing because they had been counted worthy of suffering disgrace for the name. Day after day in the temple courts and from house to house, they never stopped teaching and proclaiming the good news that Jesus is the Christ. So as we move through the early chapters of the book of Acts, it becomes very, very clear that this early church is a church that's set on fire by God. It's living for God. And as a result, the purposes for which this new family of believers were created, they're clearly evidenced again and again. They're connecting, they're growing, they're serving, they're reaching. And this is normal people like you and me, but they're filled with the Holy Spirit. And as a result, they're expressing great faith, great love, great generosity, great personal sacrifice, great courage as they share their faith with those that don't yet know Christ. The wind of God is in their sail, and amazing, wonderful things are happening. But in the midst of all this divine blessing and rapid church growth, a tricky organizational problem surfaces, and it could divide them. It could bring them down. The way the early church deals with this tricky organizational problem deserves careful scrutiny. They're dealing, first of all, with growing pains. You know, if you've ever had kids, you know exactly what growing pains are. I mean, these kids, they sleep more, they eat out of house and home, they go through awkward stages of growth. We see that in a spiritual sense in Acts chapter 6, verse 1. This is what we read. In those days, when the number of disciples was increasing, the Grecian Jews among them complained against the Hebraic Jews because their widows were being overlooked in the daily distribution of food. Now, if you've ever been a part of a growing group of believers, you know about these kinds of growing pains and the need to solve tricky organizational problems that come from such growing pains. I mean, everything was so easy when they were a small family of believers. Everybody knew everybody. They were all in each other's businesses, and they were all from the same ethnic background at first. But Jesus told them to get the gospel out so that the kingdom purposes of God would expand outward to the whole world, to all nations, to all peoples, all cultures. So let me make an observation here. God is not satisfied with a non-growth policy in any church. We are to desire growth, pray for growth, expect growth, plan for growth, work for growth, and even organize ourselves for growth. The day a church stops growing is the day a church starts dying. So do not be an enemy of church growth. Remember, numbers and growth, they're not our God. The Lord is our God. God alone makes things grow. But we, as we work together, developing a healthy church full of people who are connecting, growing, serving, and reaching, the fact is that healthy churches generally tend to grow. I also want to interject that God prunes churches for various reasons. I mean, this is happening not just across our state and our country, but across the world. Churches are being seriously pruned. Everybody's being pruned. But we know from scriptures that even the reason for God's pruning is when he does this from time to time, he's preparing us for greater growth. So if you have your sermon outline open or you've got your app open, let me give you principle number one. Church expansion requires flexibility and change. Church expansion requires flexibility and change. If we as individuals and as a church family choose to seriously embrace Jesus' charge to be filled with the Holy Spirit, with the power of the Spirit, so that we could take the gospel to the entire world, starting right here in our neighborhood and moving out, we cannot be enemies of flexibility and change, because growth or church expansion, they require flexibility and change. Let's just face it. Over the last 6 months, flexibility and change has been forced down our throats by COVID-19 through circumstances that are way beyond our own ability to control. But someday soon, we're going to come out of this COVID-19 pandemic and probably enjoy a little more predictability with our lives. Listen, we're going to start doing Creekside Inside in a couple of weeks, folks. Meeting in the venue in a limited sense, a social distance. But I want you to think about this with me. You can't organize a church of 200 believers the same way you organize a church of 1,500 believers or 3,000 believers or 10,000 believers. I have a pastor friend in Nevada County, and this guy shared with me that one evening during an elder board meeting, one of the elders stood up and said, that's it. I'm against growth. We need to stop being concerned about the people outside the church and just take care of our own. And when I heard that, I said, you know, you need to humbly ask that elder to step down. That's not a thought worthy of God. I remember in my travels as a missionary in Italy that there was this growing, really nice church in the area around Florence. And some of their church members were insisting that every single Sunday they had to take communion and they had to all partake of the same cup. They were inflexible about that. And I thought, you just put a cap on your potential for growth, let alone contacting hepatitis or COVID-19. I want you to think about this. This church, for Creekside Christian Church, it started in 1924 by 52 founding members. They were all German families. Think about that. If anywhere along the line, these believers 60 years ago, 50, 40, 30, 20 years ago had stood up and said, we resist change, where would we be today? If they said, we're anti-growth, we need to take care of our own and forget about those outside, where would we be today? But they didn't, or they wouldn't have bought this piece of property I'm standing on right now. They wouldn't have built buildings, started programs to the glory of God. Did you ever play show and tell when you were a kid? That was my favorite thing in school besides recess and lunch. But let me just play a little show and tell with you. I found this, or somebody brought this to me. This is actually a hymn book that we used to use in this church that has changed its name 4 times and its location 3 times. This is one of the first hymn books that this church ever sang with from the 1930s. Here's the problem. It's in German. Thank goodness it has English subtitles, but can we all just sing a hymn to God right now? Still wie die Nacht, wie das Meer. I don't think so. Aren't you glad they chose to change? When we come out of the coronavirus, we're going to pray that the Lord gives us back ministry momentum that we've lost during these months. And we're going to continue to dream big dreams about kingdom expansion. Now, returning to the story, the early church in Acts 6 was experiencing growing pains, but they were wonderful growing pains. Let me give you a second principle. Every problem is really an opportunity in disguise. Every problem is really an opportunity in disguise. I remember this pastor that had this big church meeting and everybody was all up in arms because of some huge problem that was challenging them all. People were angry, upset, until the pastor finally stood up and he said, yes, it's right. We have a problem. We have a wonderful problem. We have a spectacular problem. And they were all shocked by his attitude until he finally said, because when God leads us through a holy solution, it will bring him glory. So opportunity was knocking on the door of the early church that, if handled correctly through great vision and leadership, would lead to a momentous advance in this fledgling community of Christ followers. And the early church had its growing pains and complex issues to resolve, just like we do today. I remember on Tuesday morning of this week, I pulled into our parking lot and I was shocked. The parking lot was full. I haven't seen the parking lot full since March. And I thought, what's going on? Did somebody die? Oh, no. Did I show up late for my own funeral? And then I drove around the campus, and it was women's Bible studies being held outside. They can't meet inside, so they just socially distanced and moved outside. Thank you, ladies. You rock. You're flexible. You want to turn a problem into an opportunity. Yes. So don't we want to do that? If we're going to turn a problem into an opportunity, here's another great one here, folks. We printed up 1,000 of these signs. The Great Harvest Treasure Hunt. There's already one in my front yard. Come and pick up one of these signs and put it up in your front yard. Then bring candy. Then volunteer to help us with this and pray that it be used by God to reach our community. This is such good news that we just heard today the Good Day Sacramento is going to come and fill a whole portion of one of their programs on this one because it's good news. But back to Acts chapter 6, at first the organizational challenges for the early church, they were minimal. And there seemed to be roughly enough apostles to teach and to lead this new family of believers. You know, it was a decent pastoral staff, 12 apostles, a couple thousand, 3,000 people. But by Acts chapter 6, the church now numbered somewhere between 5 and 10,000 people, maybe more. And they were going to kill their apostles. They were just running into problems with local authorities, and there was too much work for 12 guys to do. The heat was being turned up both inside and outside. They needed to find a solution. The problem, frankly, was navigating racial tension. Navigating racial tension. Pick it up at verse 2. Actually, I'm going to reread verse 1. In those days, when the number of disciples was increasing, the Grecian Jews among them complained against the Hebraic Jews, because their widows were being overlooked in the daily distribution of food. So the 12 gathered all the disciples together and said, it would not be right for us to neglect the ministry of the word of God in order to wait on tables. Brothers, choose 7 men from among you who are known to be full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom. We will turn this responsibility over to them, and will give our attention to prayer and the ministry of the word. This proposal pleased the whole group. They chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit, also Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, and Nicholas from Antioch, a convert to Judaism. They presented these men to the apostles, who prayed and laid their hands on them. I want to just stop for a second and have you draw your attention to something. If you trace the central thought of the book of Acts, you're going to discover that these verses here in chapter 6, they contain some of the earliest seeds of the church really opening its heart toward outsiders, towards people who were different than the original group of believers. Our God's heart is just so big. Remember that people are selling entire estates, giving them money to the church so that it can grow and meet the growing needs of those joining the faith. These were amazing, exciting days. And as is often true with growing churches, the number of needy widows among their ranks increased as well. You get a lot of women who had lost their husbands and were economically very vulnerable, even destitute. They had been born again, and they were walking with the Lord Jesus Christ, but they were needy. So it seems obvious from these verses that the early church had developed an in-house benevolence food distribution program to care for their needy widows. Sort of an in-house food bank. The Bible tells us later, family should take care of such widows, but if the widows have no family, they lean on the church. And so the church was making sure that these vulnerable ladies within their rosters had enough to eat. That was a big deal. Now, I don't know if you ever thought about this, but this is a pretty strong hint right here that already as early as Acts chapter 6, we have church membership because they knew who were on the rosters and they knew who were on the rosters as needy widows. But not all of these widows in the early church were the same. That's where it got a little interesting. Some were, and others were, Let's talk about these differences, okay? You've got Hebraic Jewish widows, and you have Grecian Jewish widows. They shared certain things in common. They all came from the same religious background. They were all Jewish. They came from the same, they were also converted to faith in Jesus Christ, both of them. Their marital status was always the same. They were single. And they also had another issue that they were all poor and hungry every single day, all of them. That's what they had in common. But what about what made them different? The Hebraic Jewish widows, they were native Israelites, okay? Whereas the Grecian Jewish widows were foreign-born Israelites. They were transplants. They were immigrants that had later immigrated to Israel. The mother tongue of the Hebraic widows was Hebrew or Aramaic. That's what they spoke in their home. The mother tongue of the Grecian widows was Greek because they grew up in a Greek world. The lingua franca of the Roman world was Greek. The cultural background of these ladies was different too. The Hebraic widows, their background was very Jewish. That's what they knew. That's what they grew up with. Israel, the synagogue, the temple. But the background of the Grecian Jewish widows was Hellenistic. They grew up as outsiders in Greek culture, surrounded by Greek things. So the openness to outsiders among the Hebraic widows was pretty low because they didn't have much contact with the outside world. Whereas the Grecian Jewish widows growing up outside of Israel, their openness to outsiders was high. Remember, all of the apostles grew up in Israel. They were Hebraic Jews. They were natives of Palestine. Most of the early converts fit into that category as well. So it was probably the Hebraic Jewish converts of Christ to Christ that probably controlled the bread dole to the widows in the early church. And as silly as it may seem, there was evidence that they were giving preferential treatment to their own, to the widows of Hebraic Palestinian descent. This was a real problem. I mean, many probably didn't view it as a big problem, but it had the potential to be explosive. You know, sometimes these prejudicial matters, they may seem a little trifling to some, but verse 1 says that the Grecian widows were actually being overlooked in the daily distribution of food. You know, maybe it was just that the Hebraic Jewish widows were served first, or perhaps given a little more food, or the first pick of what was available. Maybe it was just straight up neglect. I don't know. But whatever was going on was wrong because the behavior was not based on the fact that everyone in the family of God is of equal importance. Friends, you talk about a relevant passage of Scripture to address a hot-button issue like stuff we're facing today. Scripturally, we are told that our race, our gender as male and female, our economic status, our cultural background, the clothes we wear, the language we speak, the food we eat, it all dissolves as a potential barrier at the foot of the cross. I mean, in Paul, in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 14, he actually gives us a verse between about the barrier between Jew and Gentile, but it also fits between Grecian Jewish widows and Hebraic Jewish widows. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 14, we read this, Christ himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility. I remember when I was a pastor in Fresno, we discovered that 50% of Fresno County was Hispanic. It had crossed that threshold. So we decided to start a Hispanic Spanish-speaking church on our campus, even integrating their children's Sunday school program into the rest of the church. It was a little hard to get off the ground, but it was great. But I remember we called a Hispanic pastor from Puerto Rico, and he did something funny. He knew that there was prejudice even among Hispanics, a pecking order. And so they made introductions every single week. This was a great, fun church. But he would ask, how many of you are from El Salvador? And everybody would raise their hand. And they'd be a little puzzled. How many are from Mexico? Everybody would raise their hand. How about Guatemala? Everybody would raise their hand. How about Nicaragua? They raise their hands again. Puerto Rico. How about Argentina? They all raise their hands. Everybody raised their hands to every question. It wasn't exactly true, but think about this. It was a strong statement that they would not have a pecking order in this new church, they would view each other as equal before the Lord Jesus Christ. And while I'm at it, let me tell you something else. I praise God that Elk Grove is one of the most diversified communities in California and in the United States. We here have a foretaste of heaven right in our backyard. Elk Grove's racial diversity in 2019 is actually, it's actually stayed fairly constant over the last 10 years, although it's drastically changed from years before. The Asian population is growing just slightly faster than other races. You've got the stats there on the screen, but one of the things that was a bit of a shocker to me is the percentage of foreign-born residents in Elk Grove. Almost one in four people in Elk Grove was born out of the United States. Now, I'm not quite sure how you reach people that maybe don't speak English well and live very different cultural realities, but I think that's an opportunity knocking. As we seek to reach all peoples in the Elk Grove area, that's an opportunity. But back to the problem at hand in Acts 6. We have some disgruntled Grecian widows who are being discriminated against in a major way, and we all know what disgruntled widows can be like. They may be small, they may be skinny, they may be wiry, but they can be contrary too. Thank goodness this kind of ethnic diversity isn't a cause of problems in the church today, right? Not. So we've recognized the problem or opportunity here. The church was dealing with ethnic diversity. Let's talk about the wrong solution first. The wrong solution would have been for the church leaders to distribute the food, the apostles, right? All forms of service are critical to the health and growth of the local church, all right? So don't hear what I'm not saying. But it would have been a poor division of labor to put the food distribution assignment on the job description of the apostles. I mean, as the early church grew, the role of teaching, preaching, leading, and praying was so critical, and Jesus had prepared these men for exactly this kind of work. Eyewitnesses from the beginning, it would have been a very poor allocation of human resources to put the apostles off their role as teachers, leaders, prayer warriors, so that they could wait on tables and make sure that the food distribution to all the Christian widows of the church was fair and it was just. That's a bad solution. The right solution was to delegate this assignment to wise, spirit-filled Greek brothers. The problem was significant enough as a threat to the bond of the loving unity of the early church that it had to be dealt with quickly. It had to be dealt with head-on. Let me give you principle number three. The success of any movement is in direct proportion to the people mobilized to action. Let me read that again. The success of any movement is in direct proportion to the people mobilized to action. We have to get more believers in the game of service. The apostles rightly gathered the church together. Think about this. That would have been a hard thing to do logistically. Thousands of people. Then the apostles explained why this food distribution burden should not fall on their shoulders. I think everybody readily understood that as well. Then the apostles challenged the church itself to find seven wise, spirit-filled men for this work and then delegate it to them. The church, then at this point, they take their role seriously. They choose seven men who were Hellenistic or Greek in background. They bring them to the apostles. The apostles publicly affirm the decision of the church. They pray over these men. They lay their hands and confer the authority and delegate this to them, asking the Spirit of God to help them do their work. This was a absolutely brilliant Holy Spirit-led move by both the apostles and the church. It was a stroke of diplomatic and delegational genius. I want to make a series of observations now about how you might apply what we're reading to our local reality, okay? Observation number one. When selecting people for Christian service, look, particularly for leaders, you look for those who demonstrate a track record of wisdom and sensitivity to the Holy Spirit's leading. Secondly, the work of the ministry is to be carried out by all Christians. I mean, it's better to put seven people to work than to try to do the work of seven people, right? In Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 12 and 16, we read, it was God who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, and some to be pastors and teachers. Why? To prepare God's people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up. Verse 16 says, as each member does its work. Observation number three. Acts chapter 6 is the birthing of the very first church deacons. Yeah, we have the verb for deacon. Actually, the word for deacon in the Greek is diakonos, and we have that verb and that whole concept surfacing here. It means one who serves or one who ministers, and then we see deacons emerging through the remainder of the pages of the New Testament. Observation number four, the New Testament mentions both men and women deacons. We have deacons and deaconesses. Observation number five, these deacons that we see in Acts 6, they were not limited to only serving tables. In other words, they did more than simply wait on tables, and there is something powerfully instructive about that, right? They were humble enough to do that. But we see in Acts chapter 6, verse 8, that it tells us Stephen was empowered to do miracles as well. And though he was not among the original apostles, God gave him that capability. Stephen still chose to wait on tables. That's quite a commentary on Stephen. I mean, you look around at what needs to be done and you just roll up your sleeves and do it. You serve. That's the greatest ability you have is availability. Observation number six. All the men selected as the first deacons of the church were Greek. But all their names are not Jewish. They're all very Greek names. Look at in Acts chapter 6, verses 5 and 6, you see their names are Stephen. That's Stephanos. It means crown in Greek. Philip, that was the name of Alexander the Great's father as well. Philippoi. Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon. You met Timon on Lion King. Parmenas, right? Nicholas from Antioch. These are all names that come from a Greek Hellenistic culture. Have you ever watched My Big Fat Greek Wedding? There's two films there, but in the first film, when the husband-to-be is marrying into this Greek family and they're introducing all the boys at the family, they just say, this is Nick, this is Nicanor, this is Nicholas, this is Nick. They're all called Nick. That's one of the most common Greek names. All of these names are Greek. What a brilliant move. Greek deacons would not neglect Grecian widows. This decision was above reproach. It guaranteed that the people hurt by the previous structure would be taken care of from now on with a much more equitable solution. You know, in this text, Stephen makes his first appearance in Acts chapter 6 in scriptures, and he will actually become the first martyr of the Christian faith later on in this chapter, which seems to indicate that waiting on tables could be dangerous. We also know Philip is going to become an evangelistic hero in Acts chapter 8. He's going to lead an amazing revival in Samaria, used by God to lead the first African to faith in Jesus Christ. Philip, by the way, also had four single daughters who had the prophetic gift, according to Acts 21:9. And then this last guy mentioned, Nicholas. I mean, Nicholas wasn't even born into a Jewish family. What are we doing here? He grew up in the great Greek city of Antioch, and then he was converted to Judaism while he was a foreigner. And later he came to faith in Jesus Christ. This guy had three major changes. He had a completely Gentile background, which seems to be the whisperings of the Holy Spirit, that the door to outsiders just keeps opening up more and more and more in the book of Acts because God wants to reach all people. And what are the results of this? I want you to look at verse 7. The results are the blessing of God continued and increased. I want you to read verse 7 with me now, okay? Acts chapter 6, verse 7. So the word of God spread. The number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly, and a large number of priests became obedient to the faith. Because of great leadership and a church that was carefully following the guidance of the Holy Spirit, the filling of the Holy Spirit, the blessings of God continued to flow and even increase. Look, the church was still unified after this. The church was still miraculously empowered. The church still multiplied evangelistically. Even priests converted to the faith. This problem slash opportunity gave the church the chance to exercise great faith in God and also great faith in each other. There was a brilliant division of labor through a strategic delegation here. And we have a vivid example that the early church was not afraid to adjust their structures in order to make room for a growing ministry. This is critical for us to understand. The early church was purpose-driven, not tradition-driven. They were love-driven and Great Commission-driven. They were on a mission. It's tragic when churches destroy ministry because they refuse to modify their structures. Let's not do that, Creekside. Let me also say that this Acts chapter 6 deacon solution expressed great love. These believers, they chose to minister in a practical way to needy widows that could give little in return. They loved in Jesus' name. Those who were lovingly served in this process, these Hellenistic Jewish widows who had converted to faith in Jesus Christ, they ended up being part of the very group that would lead the way for the church in the evangelization of the Gentile world across the entire Roman Empire. Saul of Tarsus, the Apostle Paul, came from this Hellenistic Grecian group of Jews that had converted to Christ. You know, when we deal with growing pains and tricky problems like they did in Acts chapter 6, the devil's defeated, God gets the glory, people are helped, and the family of God grows. So let me read this last verse again. So the word of God spread. The number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly, and a large number of priests became obedient to the faith. You know, this is a perfect passage for us to actually go into a time of communion. So if you have not provided a bread and the cup or some facsimile, why don't you pause this video right now and go get something while we wait, and then we'll partake of communion together. I want you to think for just a second at all of these believers from different cultural backgrounds eating together, doing life together, looking across the table at each other together, saying, you are different than me, and I love you because of what we have in common with Jesus Christ. One body broken for all of us. And so regularly, we're told in the early chapters of Acts, the believers gathered to partake of the bread together, the Lord's Supper together, which is what we do today. And they would take bread. This is a common experience in the early church. And they would break it. It was sacred. They never cut it with a knife. They broke it with their hands. And they would pass it around, and each person would take a portion of the bread as a symbol of the broken body of Christ. Why don't you do that now with me? And we read that on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he stood up before his apostles and he said, this body I give to you, it will be broken for you. And then he says, I want you to do this often. I want you to do this, partake of this in remembrance of me, remembering me. So with this, we remember you, Jesus. We are one and we choose to love each other as one body. Let us partake together. On that same night, a little later in the meal, Jesus took the cup and he passed it around to each man to partake. And he said, this cup is the blood of the new covenant that is shed for you. I want you to take this and drink this. I want you to do this also in remembrance of me. So as we remember, even as we are different people made one with the barriers brought down by the body of Jesus and the blood of Jesus, we are one and we choose to love each other because Jesus has brought down that dividing wall and he has made us one. And so let us remember that as we partake of this together. We are separated. You are watching me online, but there are many of us that are watching and being part of what's happening here. So imagine in your mind, we're all partaking together this because we are one. Let us do this. And Jesus, we partake in remembrance of you. Let us partake. Our Father, we thank you for this text in Acts chapter 6. We thank you, Lord, for the way that the church, filled with the Holy Spirit, worked through a very difficult situation in a very godly and God-honoring way. We thank you that you invite us from different nations around the world, every tribe, nation, language, tongue. You invite us to come and to be a part of your family. And so we celebrate that beauty. And we think about the foretaste of heaven we have even with all the races here in Elk Grove. And Father, we thank you that you even qualify us to be your children. So again, Lord, like the early believers, we pray, fill us with your Holy Spirit. Give us the wisdom that comes from the Holy Spirit. And remind us that it is our job to take your life-saving message to all nations. Lord, we choose to be a part of the greatest movement of history, the church ignited. We pray in your name. Amen.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I'll worship your holy name.
The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song.
Sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore. So bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy.
Forgot to give you a blessing, and I put all my cameras away, so I'm holding my iPhone by myself. But in the count of three, we're gonna put our hands together. Ready? One, two, three. Imagine my other hand, because my other hand is holding my iPhone. But may this be the blessing. May the word of the Lord spread. May his glory go far beyond the reaches of just Creekside, of just any church. May it go to all the world as the Holy Spirit empowers his church, as he empowers us. Take that in, pack it up. God bless. Have a great day.